Hello, everyone. Hello for appearing here in my last talk of the day. It's called Joomla Websites on Mobile Devices. My name is Achim Fischer. I'm from Germany, here in the near, from Fulda. Moin. Moin. And I would like to talk a little bit about mobile devices. So, but before I start, I would like to ask you, as Joomla users or website owners, what are you using? So, I'm just talking about phones. Who is using an iPhone? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Who is using an Android phone? 1, 2. Okie dokie. Windows phone? But not. He's not here. Okay. Anyone using a BlackBerry? No one. Okay. So most are using iPhones and Android phones. Good. Thank you. Anyone using, don't use a smartphone at all? So. 1, 2, 3. Okay. So, just a little bit about me. I'm running a very small web development company in my hometown Fulda. It's called Coding Fish Limited. So you find me everywhere under Coding Fish. Yeah, I'm doing pretty much everything. I'm doing some PHP, some Ruby on Rails, all kind of Java stuff. A couple of years ago, I started with classical software development. Well, it was back in the 80s. Starting with assembler coding, then C, Java, and recently I'm trying to get into this mobile device development. Just as a background information for you to understand why I'm doing what I'm doing, I must talk about the community management for ItaloBikes.com. I will show you on the next slide. And last but not least, I'm the developer of the Joomla extensions, discussions, and marketplace. First is a forum extension, second is a classified ads extension. Okay, talking about ItaloBikes, I created this site. It's an online community for friends of Italian motorcycles. It's currently in German only, sorry. But this is the reason why I'm doing everything what I'm doing. I started it in the year 2000, so it's 12 years old now. It's still running on Joomla 1.5, but will be migrated to 2.5, I hope, this year. It's a classical community with forum section, with classified ads, with images. Just scroll down a bit. You see images on Flickr, you see a module for classified ads. For people looking for something, people selling something. You see a big module in the content area, which is actually a live stream of everything, forum entries, marketplace entries. And my plan was to bring exactly these features to mobile phones. But before I started, I just wanted to know how many people actually use mobile phones. And Hagen is here. I think he created a poll on Facebook last week or the week before. Yeah. And the biggest group was 2 until 7%.
Yeah.
Okay, that's exactly what I have researched. It's a very rough estimation. Just let's say 5% of website visitors are using a mobile device. Yeah, very interesting was when you started the poll, I had a look at my own website statistics on codingfish.com, where I offer my Joomla extensions, and I was very surprised to see that only 2% are coming through mobile devices. That's not very spectacular. And then I had a look at the community ItaloBikes, and those users are really not IT related. They are motorcycle riders, dealers, everything. And again, I was extremely surprised. There were 11% of all visitors were using mobile devices. 11%. Yeah. But let's say 5% as a rough estimation. That means 95% don't use a mobile device. I think that's a spectacular number, which could bring me to the question, can we ignore it? So if you're a developer, you probably know the rule, the 80% rule, make 80% of your users happy and forget about the rest one, to say it simple. So we could say if 90 or even more percent of my website visitors don't use a mobile device, maybe we can ignore them. But of course you can't do that, because it's very dependent on the website, and the number will increase in the near future, I'm very sure. Because people still are using an old phone, not a smartphone, but sometime buy a new one, and I'm pretty sure they will buy a smartphone then. Okay, so let's imagine you have an awesome website, and I'm sure you have, and you would like to bring the experience to a bunch of mobile devices. And please take the word bunch literally. This is just a very small collection that I'm having at home in my office. And there are even more. You see 4 tablets, 500 phones. And they all have different sizes, different operating systems, and even different versions of operating systems. And it's really difficult. So basically, there are 3 solutions. We already talked about one of them. And I'm not sure if you agree if it's a solution at all. I call it ignorance. So if so many users are happy with HTML and not using a mobile device, just do nothing. Well, obviously, it's a very developer-friendly solution because you don't have to do anything. But on the right side, you see the output of my website displayed on a HTC One X, which has a pretty big screen, a 4-inch screen. But it's still not really good to use. Of course, you know it. If you get a page, you can't read it. You always pinch to zoom and move the page around and to hit the next link, and then same again on the next page, pinch to zoom. And that's not very user-friendly. Also, it's pretty slow because all the HTML and JavaScript code, which is generated on server, is pushed to the mobile device, which has to deal with it. Yeah, so I think number one is not really a solution. Then there is another way, which I call mobile web. There was a talk today from the guys from Mobile Joomla, which was very good. So if you're interested in this part and you haven't attended the talk, so please watch it on the website later. This means pages are rendered specific for the mobile devices. This is the same page I showed you before, the homepage of my website, but it's a mobile page. I'm very lucky to use a theme here, a template here, which automatically does it. This is one from a Joo theme. And, well, it's obviously much better to read and much better to move around, to hit links. It looks better than number one. It works on all devices, I hope. But it's actually not really what I want, because the look and feel is not, it looks not native on the phone. It may look this way on all phones, but this page won't look exactly like an iPhone app on an iPhone, and it won't look like an Android phone app on an Android phone. So I'm afraid we have to go with number three, which is, of course, a native app. Yeah, a native app has a lot of pros. It's looking native on every device. You have access to all device features like camera, GPS, NFC, everything you want. It's very fast because the amount of data transferred from the server to the device is very small. But the biggest problem is you have to write an app for every device, for every operating system. So you can't take an Android app and put it on an iPhone. That's a lot of work to do. Every phone or every operating system has its own programming language, different tools, emulators, so it's really hard work. I will show you how the native app approach would look like. So if you decide to write a native app, you need two things. Obviously, the native app itself for the phone, but you need as well something on the server which delivers the data. An API. The cool kid in API town is currently the REST API. I'm doing some development on Ruby on Rails as well, and this works pretty good. So an API, a REST API, defines a set of functions which a developer can send requests to, and he gets a response from. A REST API maps the HTML verbs to methods on the server. So if you initiate a GET request, you get content from the server, POST is for create content, PUT is for update content, and delete for delete content. I will give you an example. This is how it looks if you want to get a list of forums from my website. So it's API is just the menu entry for a Joomla component. I will show you later. And discussions forum is the call to the list. This call will give you this result. It's a JSON output with a bit more than two, but only these two are displayed. Forum entries. Anyone here who can see what's not so good here in this response? Have a look at the image. Any idea? Yes. I will explain later. I have a second example which requests a single post from a forum. Here's a complete path. I would like to have the forum from forum number 32, the thread number 4466, the post with the number 4470. And here is the complete forum post. And here it's right. It's another image with a complete path in it. I have to correct that in the other response, because it's not good to construct paths on the device. Why not? Because it's difficult to change something. If you decided to move the image on the server, You just have to change it here on the server side, the PHP code, and if you do it on the device, you have to roll out a new version of your app. That's a problem. So this is much better here. Always include the complete path. Yeah, as I've said, the API is created through a Joomla extension. That one is not perfect. I won't probably win a J Oscar for it. But it works. The problem currently is that we don't have anything standardized in Joomla. There's nothing we can extend, no basic stuff like APIs. We have had XML RPC in earlier versions of Joomla, but right now we don't have anything. And probably we won't see anything in the near future. I've attended a workshop yesterday for web services, and I think we have said 3.0, probably not, right, Chris? Yeah. So it will take some time. So for the next, for the near future, we have to rely on third-party extensions. I am aware that there are two existing extensions. One is from Tech Joomla. Are the guys here? No. And one is from Brian Edgerton. They're both fine. I have no problems with that. But I've decided to write an own one for one reason, because it's really a problem. If you have an app, roll it out to the App Store, and you say, okay, in order to run this app, you need an API on the server, and the webmaster has to download another app, another Joomla extension somewhere, configure it correctly, and then maybe your app works, and it's just too complicated. So I've decided to write a very simple API extension by myself. Yeah, that's a screenshot from my PHP Storm environment containing the API extension. I try to make it a little bit extensible. So here are some PHP files. I call it adapters, which are supporting my extensions. There is a small screenshot from, it's a news feed. I'm selecting a number of forum posts, a number of marketplace posts. I put all of them in a temporary table and then selected order by create date. So that's it on the Joomla side. And now I will talk about the Android app. As you've seen on the first or second slide, I have a history as a Java developer. So it was quite easy to dive into the Android app development because everything is done in Java and XML. And there is not much you really need to start Android development. Just go and download the Android SDK from Google. It's free. Just download, install it, and you're done. Grab an IDE of your choice. Many people use Eclipse because almost all tutorials are shown using Eclipse, and it's the most easy way to get started. I'm using IntelliJ IDEA because I'm using other IDEs from the same company for other programming language like PHP Storm for PHP and RubyMine for Ruby on Rails, so we feel immediately at home. And the third point is an Android device, which is optional. You don't really need it because there is an emulator. But if you have tried to work with the emulator, you would agree that this is really not good. Just do yourself a favor and get a real device. I will, if you have time enough, I will give you an example how that looks like to put an app to an emulator and to put an app on a real device. So, okay, coming back to the one of the first slides from Italo Bikes, I decided to write an app for Android which brings all the normal features a user has from the website to the mobile phone. I call it Camrua, which is a working title. I'm not sure if I keep it or change it. So I was not sure how to bring the phone screen on the big screen, so I recorded a small video, just 20 seconds or so, starting my app, browsing through the newsfeed, which contains forum posts and classified ads, and in the future, article, normal Joomla articles. You can browse through the single posts, browse through the forums, which is actually the call which you've seen before, browse through the threads in the forum. Yeah, and that's it for now. There's actually a bit more functionality, but I'm currently changing a bit in the UI. This is, by the way, Android 4 native. So you've seen maybe on top the action bar, which is available in Android 4. So this project is here seen in IntelliJ IDEA, which is Java code. And I would like to show you now how this looks like to compile and to put an app in the emulator and on the phone. So now I have to switch my environment here. So maybe nothing works in a second. Okay, that's my mouse cursor. Anyone? Monitor. Okay, I start with PHP Storm to give you a short look to the. To the Joomla extension, which is the API. Screen. Okay, it looks a bit strange here. It's a normal Joomla extension where most of the part is done here in the router. If you get the parameter heartbeat in the URL, it maps to a view, the index view, format API, and the task heartbeat feed, which is then decided in the adapter, where is it? Here. Case heartbeat feed. Then SQL statements are generated and performed, and after that the temporary table is selected and the output is constructed and sent to the device as a JSON array. That's pretty much all of the magic here. Same for other adapters. So it's a little bit extendable for me. and it's quite easy to write other adapters for example, for Joomla articles. Okay, any questions so far for here? Nope. Okay. I'm gonna fire up idea. Community edition is free, by the way, so you can try it out. Okay, here we go with the Java classes. At first, I would like to show you what happens if I hit the play button. There are two possibilities. One is to use the emulator, one is to use a real device. I have enabled a dialog, so it should ask me. And now you will see why the emulator is not really a good choice. Okay, so you can create virtual devices for the emulator. I have just one here, it's an Android 4 with Google API, so I can use maps and so on. But you can create virtual devices for all possible Android versions, so you can create one for Android 2.2 to test your app on a 2.2 phone. That's a pretty cool thing. So now I hit OK, and the app is going to be started in the emulator. Okay, now. Doesn't look very nice, but I actually don't care. So it's now starting a complete Android environment. It starts like a normal phone. And as you can see, it takes forever. At least the first start. You really should avoid, if you are using the emulator, to stop it, to cancel it, to close the window. Then the next time it will take forever again. A few hours later, okay, there it is. Android is up and running. It is very slow. So just 1 more minute and we will see an Android screen. Yeah, okay, there it is. The IDE keeps trying to put the app on it, so it should start automatically. It doesn't do anything. Okay. And here it runs. If it's finally running, it's okay, it's the usual, yeah, and you can try out your app. Pardon? What do you mean? Yeah. Well, as far as I know, it's quite like it. What do you mean? What's not working? Yeah.
And works everything if I use it on a normal screen.
Yeah.
But totally sucks when it fails. sliders, for example, in the number, because the click event and catch event are different.
Yeah.
It's not the same.
Okay, so normal
so
clicks,
on
touch.
On the link, touch and click is a back and forth.
Yeah. Okay.
So how do we test that?
I don't know. I never use the emulator.
Okay.
So I close it now. I will show you now how it works on the phone. I'll just connect my phone. So, okay, I hit play again, okay, he detects the connected device, and I say okay, and I hope that it works, and there it is. 2 seconds, and it's working. You have all the output, debug and log output here. If you move around here, hit something, you can follow what's going on the device in your IDE. We have the info. So there are some errors, whatever it does. It's not from my app. So you see, it's working and you can debug it here on the IDE. iPhone? iPhone is a completely different thing. So you have to use Xcode as development IDE for iPhone. And yeah, but it's a completely different programming language.
Yeah.
It's Objective-C. Yeah, but you can connect the iPhone with Xcode and debug it like this.
Okay.
That works, yeah. It's really a complete different thing, but it works the same way, yeah. And the same way is valid for Microsoft. Microsoft development for Windows Phone 7 is pretty similar to Android. I attended a few developer workshops for Windows Phone and I was surprised, really, how similar it is. So if you are able to create an Android app, I think you have a Windows Phone app and running in no time.
And what about Tenon?
Pardon?
Tenon?
Yeah, it's, again, something totally different. Yeah, but Titanium is not really a native app, I think.
No?
Yeah. Yeah, but I'm not sure what it exactly does, so I can't say anything about it.
So Titanium is some kind of, let's say, abstract JavaScript language.
Yeah. Yeah.
Then Titanium uses for iPhone, it uses Xcode, so it produces Objective-C code for iPhone IDE, and it produces Java code for Android.
Okay.
And it and the other things are in working stage.
Yeah. So it's So it it's a kind of code generator.
It's a kind of code generator.
Yeah, so.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, but you if want to have really access to every single device feature, you can't use it, probably.
Yeah.
As you said, for rather simple applications, it would be fine. Yeah. There are many possibilities. It's up to everyone which one he chooses. So anyone more questions? Okay, practice time is over. So if you have any suggestions or would like to contact me, follow what I'm doing, you're a little bit too late because I'm done. Then just contact me. Here you go, just search for Coding Fish on Facebook, on Twitter or everywhere. And don't hesitate to contact me. Thank you, guys. Thank you.